Like to call this meeting to order and indicate that we are meeting electronically under bylaw number 52-2020, section 3.10, that allows for electronic participation of council meetings. I would like to welcome all members of council and our staff that are with us this morning. We look forward to staff giving us sound advice so that we can make the best decisions on behalf of all of our residents of ACW. And a happy new year to everyone. And we know that 21 will be a much less stressful year than what we experienced in 20. At this time, do any members of council have any pecuniary interest to indicate at this time? Mr. Vanstone, please.
Yes, I do, Mr. Mayor. It's 5.2 on your agenda and I filed the appropriate papers.
Thank you very much for that, Bill. Everyone else is good? Okay, Mark, please.
So, Councillor Bill Vanstone, section 5.2, the consent application C90-2020. And I have received the declaration of interests as Bill indicated prior to today's meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Mark and Bill. Now we'll entertain a mover and a seconder. We have some council meeting minutes to adopt. And first would be the December 11th council meeting minutes. A mover and a seconder for the adoption of those, please. And that is Councillor Vanstone, seconded by Councillor Miltenberg, that Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh Township Council hereby adopts the December 11th, 2020 council meeting minutes as written. Are there any questions on those minutes? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion? And that is carried. I thank you for that. And now for the December 15th council meeting minutes. A mover and a seconder, please. That is Councillor Forrester, seconded by Councillor Snowblin, that Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh Township Council hereby adopts the December 15th, 2020 council meeting minutes as written. Are there any questions on those minutes? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion? And that is carried. I thank you for that. And now on to the December 17th council meeting minutes. A mover and a seconder, please. And that is moved by Councillor Fisher, seconded by Councillor Snowblin, that Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh Township Council hereby adopts the December 17th, 2020 council meeting minutes as written. Are there any questions on these minutes? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion? And that is carried. Thank you. Open forum is an opportunity for any members of the public to make any comments that they would like to council on any agenda item we have this morning. Brett, are you aware, is there anyone that would like to speak at open forum?
Nobody that I've been made aware of. We do have one person in attendance. If they do wish to speak, there's a raise hand function available to you. If you hit that, we can allow you to speak. So nobody else that I'm aware of.
Thank you very much for that, Brett. So we're good with that. We'll now move on to delegations. And I would like to welcome Selena Whaling-Ray to our meeting this morning. Welcome, Selena. Happy New Year to you.
Hi, everyone. Happy New Year.
And this is a housekeeping amendment for the Township of ACW. And so, Selena, would you like to address council on this, please?
Sure. Thank you, Mayor McNeil. I don't have a presentation prepared today. I think the report summarizes, again, largely what we're proposing to change. I'll maybe just let council know I have received comments from three different landowners. The first was just some questions about second units potentially in the AG1. And so we did discuss sort of the direction of council moving forward into the official plan review, and that landowner was satisfied with that answer. And then just another couple landowners asking questions about the proposed zoning changes on a number of the properties that are proposed to be changed to utility. Just for context for council, we did discover that there are a number of well houses in the township that are zoned mostly natural environment at the moment. And so it is staff's recommendation that those be rezoned to utility to reflect their use. That way, in an instance that there needs to be a permit issued for repair of the pump house or expansion of the pump house, that zoning is appropriate and would allow for that to happen. And those commenters, I believe, were satisfied with that explanation as well. So that's just a summary of the public comments we've received thus far. Other than that, happy to answer any questions or concerns that council may have.
Okay, thank you for that. And I must apologize. On our agenda, I should have adjourned our regular council meeting. So I would ask for a mover and a seconder to do that. And that would be Councillor Forrester, seconded by Deputy Watt Mayor. That Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh Township Council hereby adjourns our regular council meeting. And I apologize again for that oversight. All in favor of that? And that is carried. And I would entertain a mover and a seconder to open our planning advisory public meeting. And that is Councillor Miltenberg moves and Councillor Vanstone seconds. All in favor of that motion. And that is carried. And I thank you for that. This is a public advisory committee meeting. I would like to call it to order and ask if any members of council have any pecuniary interest to indicate on this meeting. Seeing none, the purpose of the meeting is a housekeeping zoning amendment to make a number of minor changes to numerous definitions and provisions, which will result in increased clarity with regard to the intent of the bylaw. The amendment primarily proposes text changes to the zoning bylaw and does not introduce widespread mapping changes. This is a requirement that the council hold at least one public meeting that notice be given. An application was submitted by the Township of Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh and notice of the public meeting was advertised by the municipality. I guess at this time, do you have any further comments to make on this, Selena, before we would entertain any other comments?
None at this time, thank you though.
Okay, any members of staff like to make any comments? Anyone else? We're good, okay. Any members of council, Deputy Mayor first, please.
Thank you. I just want to get something clear in my mind. When I was reading through this thing, I got to the AG1 section and noticed that second residences weren't permitted. And then I said to myself, oh yeah, right, that's part of the official plan changes. And I got to the AG4 and saw that second residences are permitted. And I got myself confused as to when that happened.
Sorry, through the mayor, that is one of staff's recommendations, is that with the direction that we are going to be potentially allowing second farm residences in the AG1, that second units similar to those permitted in the VR1 zone may be appropriate. So that, again, it would be similar to what we do permit already in VR1, which would be the second unit being in the primary residence or an accessory building. If that is not the direction of council, by all means, we can take that out, but that's just staff's recommendation at this time.
Thank you for that, Selena. Deputy Mayor, please.
Yeah, that's not what I meant. My confusion is the fact that the document says that second residences are not permitted in AG1, but it does say that second residences are permitted in AG4. And I cannot remember when that happened, how that came about, because my little brain tells me we had not permitted second residences in any agricultural zoning.
So currently the language of the bylaw does not permit second residences anywhere in the agricultural zone. The language being proposed is a second unit in the AG4, so it wouldn't permit a second farmhouse outright. It would be rather a secondary unit within an existing house or an accessory building. And then the direction, of course, being of council, is that during the official plan review, an actual second residence be permitted in the AG1 zone. So the second unit, again, it wouldn't be a new structure permitted. It would be similar to, say, like a what you would see in the VR1 zone as like a basement unit or something like that. So that is what's proposed for the AG4 zone. And then of course that second farm residence being more appropriate for the AG1 zone down the road. So that's what's proposed by staff. I hope that's answers your question, Deputy Mayor Watt, but we can certainly take those provisions out as well if that's not the direction of council.
Oh, I wasn't arguing for taking provisions out. I was arguing for putting them in, and then I realized that had to come through the OP. But I will go back and check the zoning bylaws because I don't remember that we ever allowed secondary residences in AG4s.
No, currently we don't allow second units in AG4s, and this would be a change in policy direction that would be have to be reflected in the OP should this be the direction of council. It was staff's idea that a second unit in AG4 would be a major enough change to, I guess, wait until the OP review is done, should it be the direction of council, whereas the secondary farm residence is definitely a larger policy shift that would be, I think, more appropriate for the OP review.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Vanstone, please.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. We were talking about some changes for designating land to maybe move it to RR1 or development. Are these incorporated in this now, or are they in the future?
Through the mayor, this would be in the future. This is not included in this scheme.
Okay, and one more quick one, if I could.
Please.
Cemeteries, I was reading that, and there's an A designation there for the distance, and I couldn't find out what that distance was. What is that distance?
Through the mayor, that distance would vary depending on the barn that's proposed. So this was quite a while ago, admittedly. I think it was back in the winter when we chatted about whether or not council wanted to treat cemeteries as type A or type B land uses. So that number would vary depending on the agricultural operation that's proposed. And that's a calculation through OMAFRA that Brett and Joy in the building department calculate whenever they're issuing permits for a new barn. But that type A land use basically gets a shorter distance than that type B land use would essentially be the difference there.
Okay, so it's set. Okay, all right, thank you. I just couldn't find the numbers, but that's good.
Thank you. Councillor Miltonberg, please.
Yeah, this is the follow-up with Roger's questions there. And so now I'm trying to get it clear in my own head because I'm now confused. Probably should have been confused earlier. So currently there is no AG4 second residences allowed. This, which we're putting under housekeeping, would allow them similar to that it is in VR1. So we're saying a basement, you know, apartment, are we saying garden suites or whatever we're calling them now, the residence that doesn't, is less than 1300 square feet and doesn't have a basement and whatever is used on AG1s, is that now allowed in AG4s?
Through the mayor, so garden suites / temporary dwellings have always been permitted, well, none of them are permitted as right in the zoning bylaw, it requires improvement through council. So nothing's changing there. People can still apply for a temporary dwelling permit. The change here is that essentially you would be allowed to apply for a permit for a second unit within an existing residence. So just to be clear, there wouldn't be a second residence permitted. It would just be a second unit within an existing residence for likely rental purposes would largely be the purpose there.
So this was never allowed before, and this housekeeping thing would let it be allowed in the AG4s.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. Brett, would you like to shed some light on this situation, please, for us?
Yeah, I'll try and clarify this. AG1 allows for the temporary dwellings, garden suites, and large dwellings. So the AG1, generally speaking, allows for a second unit. It's just kind of worded differently. The AG4 has never been allowed a second unit period of any type. So now this change would allow for a second unit within the dwelling or possibly an accessory structure, but not a temporary dwelling or an enlarged dwelling. So the zone provisions in AG1 are totally different than AG4. AG4 properties were felt to be more similar to residential properties. So why not have a second unit permitted within the dwelling? It just seemed to kind of make sense. So the AG1's a whole other animal, where certain things are allowed, they're just kind of worded differently. The AG4 never had anything, and so the only thing going forward in the AG4 would be these second units, if that helps.
It does. And Brad, if I could just ask a straight question, is there a downside to this, or it kind of makes sense, I think, to me. What are your thoughts?
And I think it makes sense. We do get the odd inquiries to have second units in the AG4, but the answer has always been no. Whether that's, you know, just retiring farmers or kids, people that just need a little extra help. There's different conversations that are had. And you can pretty much do it in any, you know, in a VR1 or an AG1. Just for some reason, the AG4 never was granted these sort of provisions. So it just seemed to make sense to move forward on that.
And I concur with that. It does make sense, I feel, in my mind. Deputy Mayor, please.
I'm looking at the definition of second unit, and it still doesn't jive with what I'm hearing. Because according to page 159, section 28.8.6, it's not just a dwelling within or an attached structure, it's an entire second residence. If we're sneaking in this housekeeping amendment allowing it in AG4, then I think we should do it in AG1 also. Otherwise, this is going to create a hell of a confusing situation.
So great, I think, point, and we want to eliminate confusion.
So,
Brett, and then Selena, please.
Yeah, so in the AG1, there are, like I said, there are second units permitted. They're just kind of called enlarged dwellings. It's kind of a different terminology, and Selena can correct me if I'm wrong, but it's more a terminology, I think, that's kind of maybe confusing everybody a little bit, and maybe that's something we address when we do the OP / zoning bylaw update again in a few months ahead. So maybe we can tidy that up and make it a little more clear yet. If that's
a use consistent terminology.
Maybe that's a better, maybe we can look at that moving forward with the next bylaw update.
Selena, before I go back to Deputy Mayor, please. Thanks, Brett.
So when I'm referring to second unit, I'm speaking more to the definition under the definitions. And that does refer to an accessory dwelling unit with its own kitchen, bathroom and bedroom, sleeping area, and within a single detached dwelling or accessory building. So that would be when Brett / myself are evaluating applications that refer to second unit, that would be the definition that governs that use. Within both the AG4 and VR1.
Okay, thank you for that. Deputy Mayor, are you good with this? If we had consistent terminology used, you're not. What's your comment, please?
Oh, if we had consistent terminology used, it's the issue that I'm having problems with is making what I consider to be a non-editorial change. It's allowing something we hadn't allowed before in what's supposed to be a housekeeping amendment to the zoning bylaws. If we're going to do that in one zone, I don't see why we don't put it into AG1 at the same time. Unless I am totally confused, in which case I'm concerned because I'm confused.
Okay, thank you for that. Councillor Forrester, please.
Okay, so when I read this, that second unit, I thought it was like with a basement and everything. There's nothing in there that says temporary. So I don't know if everybody else feels that way, but that's the way I feel. Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Wayne. And I'll look for a response from who's itching. Brett first, please.
Yeah, so the second unit, like Selena was mentioning, these are a second unit. We'll just kind of see if we can get all on the same page of what everybody's considering a second unit. A second unit, the way has been drafted in the bylaw, is within the dwelling or an accessory structure. So it is not a second residence. It's not a permanent second residence. It's not a temporary dwelling. It's just a unit within another existing building. I think the confusion may be in, and maybe I'm misunderstanding it as well, is with these temporary dwellings. The temporary dwellings, to make them permanent, I think is more what Roger and maybe Wayne is referring to, is which was something that we were leaving till the OP discussions. Hey, Roger.
I don't agree with your interpretation of what section 28.8.6 says. There's nothing in 28.8.6 that says it has to be an attached structure. As a matter of fact, the fact that only one driveway is permitted to serve both units leads one to believe that we're talking about separate structures here. And that's the way it reads. No matter what we say it means, we have to go by what it says. And this thing provides a separate second residence by definition. The only part about where it's, if it's contained within the existing structure, the only part of that that refers to that is the first section that says if it's on an upper floor, the stairway getting to it has to be around the back. It doesn't say that the thing has to be contained within the existing structure. Therefore, it's permitted to be a separate unit, separate dwelling. If we're going to do it for AG4, we should do it for AG1. Otherwise, we shouldn't do things like that in a textual update.
Okay, so yeah, I get your point, 100%. So I'm going to take a step here. What's the downside of doing it in both AG1 and AG4 to be consistent? And that question's to Selena and Brett. Please, Selena first.
So at one of the past OP discussions when we were discussing secondary farm residence, I believe it was Councillor Miltenberg who brought up the point that in theory you could have one property where they have, say, a second farm residence, a temporary dwelling, an enlarged dwelling, etc. I think the rationale behind not allowing it in the AG1 zone was to avoid a situation where you have a high number of units on one property. As Brett referenced before, the opportunity for additional dwelling units, whether they be temporary, enlarged, etc., it already exists in the AG1 zone, whereas it doesn't at this time in AG4. I think to respond to Deputy Mayor Watt's comment, he is correct in that this is a change of use that is different than the direction that we had before. And if council's direction is to not make such a change during a zoning bylaw housekeeping amendment, that can certainly be taken out. And then this topic revisited during the official plan, post-official plan zoning bylaw update. So that would be my comment on those two.
Okay, thank you for that, Selena. Councillor Vanstone, did you have a comment to make? Please.
I just like to get some clarification because I have read it the same as everybody else, that I thought it was a second residence we were allowing now, just the way it was read. And so I guess if we're confused, the public should be more confused. So I'd like to see some clarity on it and maybe bring it back if we have to.
Brad, please.
I get where everybody's coming from here. I think if we were to add this provision to the AG1 and bring it back, as Bill suggested, maybe we would consider capping the number of units on an AG1, because there are a lot of other units already permitted there. And maybe council doesn't have any interest on how many, but at least until we got through our OP, if council wanted to add this to AG1, a cap might be a good idea, but just a thought, so.
Deputy Mayor, thanks for that, Brett. Deputy Mayor, please.
It pains me greatly to suggest that we take this out of AG4. I think it's just totally inappropriate to change a use in what is supposed to be a housekeeping amendment, which is supposed to just be minor editorial changes for clarification purposes. We're sneaking something new in here.
I was waiting for, thank you for that, Roger, and I was waiting for Councillor Miltenberg to weigh in. So, Jennifer, please.
I agree totally with Roger. I appreciate staff's sentiment, and while I agree with it, I don't think it's the best way to do it, particularly the amount of conversation. If it requires that much conversation, it's not housekeeping. It's something new. And I think I really support the idea, but I don't think this is the time or the place.
Okay, so the sentiment, Selena, please. Thanks, Jennifer.
I was just going to respond to those comments and say, and maybe Mark or Florence can cut me off if this is incorrect, but I believe a way to resolve this would be if council were to pass a 3417 motion, I were to just delete the text that referenced the second unit in the AG4. I believe that would allow for the rest of the bylaw to be passed at this public meeting, should that be the direction of council, would be the straightforward way to go if this is the only change that council would wish to see.
That's a really good comment. Yeah, I can. Brett, do you think that's a reasonable approach?
Well, I completely agree. If this council feels this is too big of a change, then I fully support the idea of looking at this at the with the bigger scope. So, yep.
Roger, Deputy Mayor, would you be in agreement with that? And then I would like to go to our clerk, please, or our CAO.
As I said, reluctantly, yes.
CAO, please.
Oh, for what I'm hearing is that change with respect to the second residence is we don't want to address that today and address it at a later date. And I think what Selena's talking about, and I don't have the motion ahead of me because normally Selena would provide that ahead of the meeting if we needed to. A resolution basically saying that council agrees with everything that's proposed except for that one paragraph, or how many paragraphs it is, I don't know off the top of my head. And we don't need to recirculate, and we could, I guess, bring it back to the next meeting. We just have to adopt that resolution, just removing that one section, and we'll deal with that section later on. I know I said that, but is that correct, Selena? Is that what you're thinking?
Yes. So, CAO, if I were to send you that motion, then I believe we can we could pass the rest of the bylaw today if that were the direction of council. And then that motion would just clarify that the actual bylaw passed is slightly different than that advertised in the agenda because of those deleted.
The only other option is we could just defer it to the next meeting because we've already advertised and we could pass the motion at a later date.
Right. Thank you.
I think I would prefer to do that because the way the bylaw reads right now includes that. And I want to be certain that when council sees it the second time, that it has what they want in or out. And I would highly recommend that we just defer this to the next meeting. And Selena, you know better than I do with regards to whether that motion needs to be passed for the Planning Act, whether we need to pass that particular motion saying we're deferred it and we don't need to re-advertise because the changes were minor.
Correct. Yeah. Thank you.
Florence, I don't know if you're listening in, whether you agree with what I just said.
Good morning, everybody. Yes, I do agree. I think given the nature of the change in the text of the bylaw, just to make sure everything's 100% in square, we should defer it to the next meeting with the resolution as well as the bylaw.
I concur with that. I think we've had good discussion on this and we want to be sure in our minds that it's the right thing. So to defer is the correct process. Would you like a motion to that effect, CAO, or what's your preference?
No, I think what I'll do is I'll just put the recommendation of the Planning Advisory Committee is to defer this matter to the next meeting. However, Selena, is it required that we pass that resolution today, or can it be brought back to the next meeting just before we pass the bylaw?
It can be brought back to the next meeting just with
perfect.
The bylaw.
Perfect, because I'd rather pass the motion that I don't have ahead of me at the next meeting when I do have it ahead of me.
Okay. Totally. So the recommendation is to defer. Is council all in agreement with this? I don't see. Yep, I think we are. Okay, you're good with that, Deputy Mayor, to defer to next meeting?
Yes.
And Mark, please.
I would suggest if council have any other concerns or comments with anything with the rest of the bylaw. I know we focused a lot on that one section, but if there was any other sections, I think this is the opportunity to discuss that.
That's a good point, Mark, and thank you for that. Are there any other concerns in any other areas of council? I don't see any. Deputy Mayor, please.
Yeah, somewhere under natural environment or somewhere there's a thing that says that detached decks will be permitted in the front yards of lakefront properties. I think we need a bit more wording in there, because to me that means that, and it says including below the bank, to me that means that a lot of cottage owners are going to start constructing structures, because the bylaw, zoning bylaw, says they're permitted. Saying that they're permitted doesn't mean you don't need a building permit, but a lot of people aren't going to read it that way. I think Selena? We're going to have a number of situations, even worse than we currently have, where people are going to start building things without applying for building permits, because the bylaw permits it. It's already permitted. I don't need a permit.
Through the
good,
mayor.
Good comment. Selena, response, please.
Maybe Brett, what size is it, again, that there is no permit required? Is it 200 and... Yes.
108 square feet, so 10 square meters is the trigger for a building permit. The back, because this is kind of goes back a long time when we last had these conversations. So I think the original, we'll go back to the start just for council's clarification too. The general idea, and we had spoke a long time ago with Deputy Mayor Watt as well, was to allow something, because people are doing things along the lake and it's hard to enforce it without allowing something. So the idea was to permit certain size of structures. The shed was just a 10 by 10. It's less than 108 square feet. No building permit would be required for that. Decks were a little bit bigger. They're a little bit easier to issue permits on. So the bylaw is written quite larger. So about double the size, 200 square feet. And the other thing that changed was Maitland Valley started issuing permits for these structures as well. Was historically Maitland Valley wouldn't even permit anything in these areas. That kind of has changed recently, which was another trigger to start allowing some form of structure through the lakeshore. I don't know if that's helping or just confusing. With the zoning bylaw, and to get back to Roger's question whether they'd interpret it, a permit is required for anything over 108 square feet. It says, you know, in the VR1 you're allowed to have a house, but doesn't mean you just go build a house. It says you can have a shed. I don't know, with as maybe something, if it was as permitted by the township and the MVCA with that came with it, would that maybe help, Roger?
Yeah, I see an affirmative and I concur. I think we need it very clear, don't you, Deputy Mayor?
Yes, please.
Yeah, and Councillor Vanstone, please.
Yeah, and I was going to bring this up before we got out of this. I saw in there that with the wellhead outfit, there's going to be more restrictions on lots. Is that true? And what are they?
And good question. I think Selena would like to respond to that, please.
Through the mayor, there's no additional restrictions. The changes that the Clean Water Act has been amended and now requires that we, as the township, include source water protection provisions in our zoning bylaw. So those provisions have applied since 2006. The only difference is we are required by the province now to include them in our zoning. But typically, it's still going to be the same process, in that if you're in a wellhead protection area and you do require a permit, we'll just be directing landowners to source water protection. But those provisions are what has regulated in ACW all along. It's just we are required now to include them in our zoning bylaw.
So is there going to be more charge then to the landowner if they have to go through this different agency?
No, the fees, I actually don't even, I don't think there is a fee. No, nothing. Basically, process is the exact same level of regulations, the exact same. It's just that legislation we have to include now in our zoning bylaw.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for that. Deputy Mayor, please.
Thanks. As I recall, the only restriction on the property owner for being within the 100-meter zone of a wellhead is that you have to have your septic system inspected every 5 years.
Okay. Any further comments on any other items in this? I don't see any. Anita, Gloria? Everybody's good. Roger, you're good to cease the conversation at this point and just defer and bring this back to our next meeting. You good at that, CAO?
Yes, and as long as Selene is quite comfortable with what changes need to come forth, and with Clerk Florence, make sure they're both on the same page, they know what changes Council wants moving forward, we're going to bring this back.
Okay, and thank you very much, Selene, and to Brett for your response to answers for clarification of Council. We certainly appreciate it. Okay. So the sentiment is to defer. We will bring this back to our next meeting. With that, are there any further comments of this public meeting before I would ask for an adjournment of it? Seeing none, I would entertain a mover and a seconder to adjourn at 9:36. And that is moved by Councillor Miltenberg, seconded by Councillor Forrester, that there being no further business, the public meeting be closed at 9:36 a.m. and all in favor of the motion. And that is carried. I thank you for that. And now I would entertain a mover and a seconder to reconvene our regular council meeting. And that is moved by Councillor Fisher, seconded by Councillor Vanstone, that the Township of ACW reconvene our regular council meeting at 9:37 a.m. All in favor of the motion. And that is carried. I thank you. Selena, would you like to address us, please, on the consent file C90-2020, please? And Brett will remove Councillor Vanstone from the meeting at this time. CEO?
If Brett could
Sorry, Mark.
I just want to make sure Brett puts Bill in. There he is. He's gone. Thanks. Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you for that, Brett. Selena, would you like to address us on this file, please?
Sure. Thank you, Mayor McNeil. So as mentioned, this is file C9020. The owner and applicant is Bill Vanstone, and the subject property is located at 81216 Lucknow Line. So here we just have an aerial photo of the subject property. This consent application was submitted for the purpose of a minor lot enlargement. The property proposed to be enlarged is also owned by the applicant, and it is located in the southeast of the subject property. It's that bit outlined in red there. It is the applicant's intention to eventually further subdivide the adjacent property just mentioned for residential purposes in the future, as it is within the settlement area of Ben Miller. The minor lot enlargement is proposed essentially to address servicing needs for this property, which I will touch on later on. So the total size of the subject property proposed to be severed is 71.6 acres. The retained parcel is 71.1 acres, and it is designated extractive, agriculture, natural environment, and settlement area in the ACWOP. It is zoned general agricultural AG1, natural environment NE1, and village hamlet residential low density VR1. The severed parcel, which is outlined in yellow here, is just over half an acre, and it is designated settlement area and is zoned VR1. So essentially the applicant is proposing the minor lot enlargement in order to accommodate future septic systems for three potential lots intended to be severed at a future date. This is necessary based on a nitrate study that was conducted for the red parcel. Essentially, the hydrogeologist indicated that a minimum of 2.9 acres was required to support three private septic systems in the subject location. So currently that adjacent property in red is 2.36 acres. And so the minor lot enlargement will essentially give that property the necessary 2.9 acre parcel size. The severed parcel is considered an area of archaeological potential, and that is due to its close proximity to the Maitland River. The applicant has not yet done an assessment for the parcel, and so as such, it is recommended that the township place a holding on that parcel to ensure that no construction occurs in this area until such a time that the assessment is completed. The holding will not prohibit future residential development of the adjacent property should this application be approved. There is adequate space for three building envelopes within the parcel that is red. The additional space that would be given by the emergence of the severed parcel is only required essentially for nitrate and sewage effluents. And so both the applicant and the ACW building department is in agreement with this direction. So essentially, just to clarify, should the yellow and red parcels merge and the holding be placed on the yellow parcel, the applicant's intent is to create three building envelopes within the red parcel, and the yellow parcel would just essentially be used as open space as required by that nitrate study for the purpose of the private septic systems. There is also a development agreement on file for the property outlined in red. This was signed between the applicant and the township in 2001. It's just a standard agreement that stipulates that a building permit cannot be issued for the property until a lot grading and drainage plan is submitted, a site plan submitted, entrance permits are obtained, etc. The building department has confirmed that they have no objections with the subject application, as the development agreement can be dealt with at a future date when this development is proposed. So other than that, comments were received by Huron County Public Works. They have no concerns, and no comments were received from neighbors or the municipality of Central Huron. Section 8.8 of the ACWOP does permit severances for the purpose of assembling land for future development, as is proposed here. And so it is recommended that this application be approved, subject to conditions that conditions imposed be met within 1 year of the date of notice of decision, that all municipal requirements be met to the satisfaction of the township, that the sum of $250 be paid to the municipality as cash in lieu of parkland, that a survey and reference plan be submitted for the severed parcel, where the violation of any zoning bylaws evident, the appropriate variance or amendment be obtained, that a holding symbol be placed on the severed parcel to the satisfaction of the township, and that the applicant provide an undertaking just confirming that this severed parcel will be merged with the adjacent property to the satisfaction of the county. So I know there was a number of details on that one. I'm happy to answer any questions that council may have at this time.
Thank you for that, Selena. And do any members of council have any questions? And I'll first start with Councillor Miltenberg, please.
Thank you. The triangle that's being severed, you said was for open space for sewage needs. Does that mean it's actually going to be a weeping bed, or can it still be farmed and it just has to be there? Do you know that?
Yeah. Selena, please.
Through the mayor, so there won't be any disturbance of this. It could theoretically still be farmed. It just has to be essentially a part of that larger lot so that that effluent is contained.
Okay, thank you.
Good. Any further questions? Selena, I had a question for you. You're recommending a holding symbol. What is the advantage of that over it being a condition that there be an ARC study done in advance of it?
So maybe if I can provide some context, originally when chatting with Bill, this was not his intention. His intention was to proceed with just severing that red lot. He did then require an archaeological assessment for that red lot as well, considering that it is also within the area of archaeological potential. So he went ahead, had that done at the same time as his nitrate study, and then discovered through the nitrate study that he indeed needed more land with that parcel. So he originally hadn't had that yellow parcel assessed because he didn't think that this severance would be necessary. And then that hydrogeological assessment came back confirming it would be. Essentially, the reason we thought the holding would be appropriate was because there is adequate room within that red parcel for three individual building envelopes without needing to develop on that yellow parcel. The yellow parcel, as mentioned, is just needed for the nitrates. If this is the direction of council, we could change that condition to require the assessment to occur. I think it was just felt through staff that it wouldn't be necessary if the applicant didn't want to. He would always have the option down the road if he wanted to have that holding symbol removed to do that assessment. But again, it's the direction of council is whatever we can attach condition-wise.
Thanks for that clarification. So just as a follow-up, so your comment is that it's simpler to put the holding symbol on than requesting an arc study at this point in time?
I think it's simpler because it will give the applicant the option to do either or, whereas the arc study requires that the assessment be done regardless.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. Councillor Miltenberg and then Councillor Snowblin, please.
So are you saying that the ARC study has already been done on the area outlined in red?
That's correct.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right.
Thank you. Councillor Snowblin, please.
Somewhat related, but not completely. Can you just educate me a little bit, Selena, about how future development or the designation of future development applies to an example such as this, because it's clear from the applicant that there's an intention to put three dwellings on this house. So to me, that says future development. And I'm just wondering if you could help me sort it in my head how it gets classified.
Yeah, so through the mayor, the red parcel, and maybe I could show it on the mapping, the red parcel is already considered settlement area. It is within that settlement area of Ben Miller. While it looks like it's not, that red parcel is considered settlement area. It's already zoned VR1. So those severances are allowed through the ACW official plan as of right. Whereas if this were a future development parcel, as many similar ones are, it would be lands that are designated for future development that would also permit this type of severance. So what allows this to be supported by the planning department is that this land is not designated agriculture and it's not zoned AG1. It already is designated and zoned as of right. The yellow parcel is also part of the settlement area. And so when the applicant was looking to apply, there was no concerns again about that agricultural designation. So I guess a difference between the severance and a severance of land zoned future development is that that rezoning would be required to take place. But these lands in particular are sort of permitted as of right to be developed just based on those designation lines. I'm not sure if that answers your question, Councillor Snowden, but.
Follow up, Anita, please.
So I guess when we've looked at the maps with different classifications on it and so on, you've indicated in different settlement areas parcels that were designated future development.
Mm-hmm. So an example in Ben Miller would be if you look across the road on Lucknow Line and go to the east a bit, there's that larger field, I guess that would be east of Ben Miller Line. That is all being farmed right now, and that is currently designated future development. So that's an example of lands designated future development where those are lands that were previously designated by the township to be developed in the future. And so if someone wanted to come in with a plan of subdivision, it would be supportable because the township has essentially taken the percentage of lands they're allowed to allocate to future development and put them there. The difference between that and this property is already within the settlement area. So while visually it looks as though, because it is being farmed, that it is farmland, geographically it is within Ben Miller, would be, I guess, the difference there.
Okay, you clarified it so that it's not quite as foggy. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you for the question and response. Any further questions on this? So is council all good for to approve this, recommend it to Huron County Council with conditions as noted. I'd like to see a show of hands if we are, please. And that is supported by ACW Council. Mark?
Okay, so Council agreed to recommend to the county here and that this application for consent be granted subject to the conditions as outlined in the planner's report. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much for that, Selena. And Brett, if you would like to bring Bill back into the meeting, if you would, please. We are on to our reports now. And I would like to welcome back Bill. And I would like, we're just on to 7.4.1. And I would entertain staff to just make any comments to us on this, if you would, please. Mark, Florence?
I'm just looking.
Brad, any comments?
I'm looking for Florence to chime in.
Well, I was too.
Okay.
Here and I'm sure she will. Hi, Florence.
All right. Sorry, my apologies. Internet, and I've got a little one here who's doing some school work. So it's lots of fun at my house lately. Yeah. So basically, I received a phone call from Jeremy Taylor, and Vixen is no longer in the area. And from a day-to-day perspective, George Goosey, who does the majority of the work in the township, he will still be doing the work. The idea is that the signatory and those more technical issues that need to be addressed would be handled by Mr. Taylor. So I am 100% behind this, and I'm looking for council's endorsement on that as well. So,
thank you for that, Florence, and I concur that we appreciate what Jeff has done for us and that Jeremy will do an excellent job. Any questions of council? Seeing none, I would entertain a show of hands if we were prepared to adopt that by bylaw in section 14. And that is approved. I thank you for that. Thank you, Florence. On to the borrowing bylaw, and this is customary each year. The council authorizes borrowing if staff feel necessary. We do it every year. Does council have any questions on this? Seeing none, I would also entertain a show of hands and we'll adopt that in section 14 by bylaw. And that is supported. Thank you for that. On to the consolidated bylaw. Everyone has seen that. And with the additions noted, does anyone have any comments? And Anita has been added to this on the Community Safety and Well-Being Advisory Committee. Does anyone have any comments on this before I'd ask for a show of hands? Seeing none, all in support, and we will also adopt that by section and bylaw in section 14. That is supported. Thank you for that. The Animal Control Bylaw Amendment. This again is necessary to do on an annual basis. Any questions on this? Seeing none, a show of hands, and we will also, Mark, please.
Yeah, this isn't on an annual basis. I'll let Florence chime in.
Okay, thank you. Florence?
So this is not, the renewal would be on an annual basis for those that do not pay taxes. So basically the program works in basically two different streams where those that own properties, the dog tags go on the properties every year automatically until they notify us that they do not have a dog anymore. And the amending of this will kind of clarify that as well, but also make sure that that the renewal date for dog tags for those who pay at the office will be a little sooner than originally put as March 31st. So,
okay, perfect. Thank you for that clarification. Does any members of council have any questions of staff on this? Seeing none, I would entertain a show of hands, and we will also adopt that in section 14. And that is supported. Thank you for that. The Marriage Commissioner Report is for information of council. Do any members of council have any comments to make on that? Seeing none, we will go on to the year-end 2020 council members' remuneration report. That is also for information of council. Do any members of council have any questions or comments on this? Seeing none, it is for information purposes. On to public works. Brian is in attendance this morning, and I'm sure is more than willing and capable to answer any questions on this.
Glenn, you missed 756.
Oh, I did. I apologize. Yes. The safe. Yes. And I just come. Thank you very much for that, Mark. 7.5.6, the safe restart operating stream. That is certainly good news to offset COVID-related pressures. It is for information of council. Do we have any questions or comments on this for our staff? Councillor Fisher first, please.
Do we get parameters about how we can spend this money, or is this totally up to us to decide how we use it?
I'll let Ellen chime in.
Good morning, Ellen. Welcome to our meeting. And if you'd like to respond to that, please. You may be still muted. There, you're good.
Good morning.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. So there are, there aren't specific parameters. It's a very open-ended requirement. We do have to report on how we use the funds, but it is to address operating pressures related to COVID-19. So the key word there is operating pressures, not to purchase, say, you can't go too capital. So you can't buy too many new like facilities if you're gonna build a new structure. That's not under the safe restart, but operating pressures where we would have say reduced revenues or trying to address new sort of normals due to COVID-19. So physical distancing, increased sanitation, things like that.
Thank you.
Great, thank you for the question and the response. Any further questions of council? This, Councillor Snowblin and then our CEO, please.
Can I just clarify? I think the way I read it was that the intention is that this money will go into our draft budget. Is that right? Mark's nodding.
CEO, please, for a response.
Yeah, we're proposing that we need to incorporate that $38,000 somehow into the budget next year, yes.
Okay. I think we set aside money in our last budget for COVID-related. Explain why you wouldn't put it into that envelope, or... I'm not saying that it would be the better way. I'm just asking.
Yeah. So they're two separate things. Like, council did put $100,000 into reserves, and you don't have to spend it COVID related. You can spend it however you, just because we earmarked it COVID related, it could be spent on anything. But this particular item, $38,000, has to be spent on those particular things that Ellen did spend on. So I don't want to intertwine the two of them because they're two separate things, and there's reporting requirements for this, and there isn't for the $100,000 that council put aside.
Does that provide clarity, Anita?
It provides clarity. I'm still not, I'm not an accountant, so I'm not going to remark. It just, it made sense from my point of view to put it in the other envelope, but I'm not the smartest person in the room, so, you know.
No problem. And I think the concept I'd suggest is for recording and reporting purposes for this. Okay, any further questions or comments? And we certainly welcome this to use for COVID pressures. And that is for information of council. And thank you, Ellen, for your input on that. And I apologize for skipping over that. On to the public works, 7.6.1. Brian is here to answer any questions on his report. Do any members of council have any questions for Brian? Seeing none, the weather is certainly working in our favor, Brian, and I know that we're all appreciative of that. Okay, thank you very much, Brian. And on to the committee reports now. Do any members of council have any committee reports that they would like to share with council at this time? And I'm going to start with Deputy Mayor and then Councillor Miltenberg, please.
I am pleased to report that the Goderich Fire Committee met and approved a budget, but it comes up later in our correspondence, so I'll save any comments until then.
Thank you for that, Roger. Jennifer, please.
Yeah, I didn't actually meet with them. St. Helens, as you know, we can't meet. They don't really have the ability to do a Zoom meeting due to lack of internet. I've had several phone conversations, and I believe that's how we're going to move forward. They are going to have their playground proposal on in by the end of January to be on the budget, but we simply just can't meet. So I'm having Barb Snowden call everybody. These are items that were previously agreed on. We were waiting for more quotes, but now everything is shut down due to quote COVID. So we're just going to move with what was discussed at the last meeting, get phone yeses or whatever, and then include it in whenever we are able to meet to include it in the minutes then. It's the only way they can proceed. So I guess that's a committee report without actually meeting anybody. And when they get it on the agenda, hopefully at the next meeting, then we can go with that. And I'm meeting with the Dungannon Community Alliance tonight, and that's all.
Perfect. Thank you, Jennifer, for that. Councillor Vanstone, please.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I wasn't going to bring this up, but I'm going to anyways. I was at a, well, I wasn't at it. We had a Zoom meeting through the hospital, the liaison committee. And I'd just like to bring it up that if anybody is in contact with nurses and doctors, please give them a pat on the back because they're very stressed out. There's a whole lot of things going on that people don't realize. There's people with cancer that aren't getting treatments because of this stupid COVID. There's a whole lot of things, and these nurses and doctors are feeling this more stress than anything in our Goderich Hospital. So give them a pat on the back. You know, never hurts to say nice things to them. Okay, thank you, Glenn.
Great comments, Bill, and thank you very much for that. And I would just like to reinforce those comments. If we see any caregivers, nurses, doctors, just a thanks. Well said, Bill. Any further comments or reports of anyone? Seeing none, I thank you for that. Is there any new business that anyone would like on a future agenda? Seeing none, thank you for that. And we see the correspondence as listed. Emil, the HPPH letter, landfill and fire department. Do you have any further comments you'd like to make on the fire department, or you're just ready to answer any questions, Roger, if there are any?
Sorry, I was going to comment that the manner in which that two-page budget spreadsheet is presented defies the ability of my brain to parse it out. So I got their treasurer to send me a little spreadsheet in which items are presented in the order I expected to see them, and it makes sense. If anybody else wants a little spreadsheet, I'll be happy to send it to them. Our share of it comes to what's listed there, and it does make sense.
Right on. Thank you for that. Any questions or comments of any other members of council on that? Okay, seeing none. Unfinished business. We have our meeting a week from today on the five-year natural environment update. That's a special meeting at 10 a.m. Please note. That's a reminder only. The Roma Convention is the 25th and 6th. Deputy Mayor Watt, councillors, everyone but myself on that. That's a reminder only. The Maitland Conservation Authority recommended resolution. We see it in print. I would entertain a mover and a seconder for that, and that is moved by Councillor Vanstone, seconded by Councillor Miltenberg. And we see all the text. Do we have any questions or comments on that?
I do.
Councillor Vanstone first, please.
Yes, I don't know whether we should do something as well, because Maitland Valley conservation is very important to us, because we have rivers, streams, and a lakeshore. And I don't think Toronto realizes that. I know they live on a lake, but they should. And so we lean on them a lot. So I honestly do believe if there's anything else we can do to get the government to quit defunding them, we should do it.
Excellent comment. And Deputy Mayor, would you concur that this is a good first step in passing this resolution?
Unfortunately, the wording is a little out of date. Things happened after this wording was written, but the other thing is, I thought we did this at the last meeting, passed this resolution.
No, we agreed to bring it back so everyone had an opportunity to look at it and formalize it so they knew it was on the agenda.
And in that case, I agree.
Right.
Okay. Any further comments on this? And I'd echo the comments that this is a good first step in support of this. All in favor of the motion? Deputy Mayor, CEO, please.
I had a mover by Miltenberg, but I didn't have a seconder. I didn't hear a seconder.
Sorry, Councillor Vanstone.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, are we all in favor of the motion? And that is carried. Thank you for that. We have nothing for our in-camera session, and now we will go to our bylaws. And first is the boring bylaw, and that will be moved by Councillor Vanstone, seconded by Councillor Snowblin. The leave be given to introduce bylaw number 1-2021, being a bylaw to authorize the borrowing of money to meet current expenditures, and it now be read severally a first, second, and third time, and finally passed this fifth day of January, 2021. All in favor of the motion. And that is carried. And the consolidated appointment bylaw, moved by Councillor Watt, seconded by Councillor Miltenberg. The leave be given to introduce bylaw number 2-2021, being a bylaw to appoint members to various township committees and positions, and that it now be read severally a first, second, and third time, and finally passed this fifth day of January, 2021. All in favor of the motion. And that is carried, and I thank you. Number 14.3 has been deferred, correct, CAO?
Correct, thank you.
Thank you. On to 14.4, the Animal Control Bylaw Amendment, and that is moved by Councillor Forrester, seconded by Councillor Fisher, that leave be given to introduce bylaw number 4-2021. Being a bylaw to amend bylaw number 57-2015, being a bylaw to regulate animal care and control within the township of Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh, and that now be read severally a first, second, and third time, and finally pass this fifth day of January, 2021. All in favor of the motion. That is carried. Thank you. To the confirmation bylaw, moved by Councillor Forrester, seconded by Councillor Miltenberg. The leave be given to introduce bylaw number 5-2021, being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of the Township of Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh meeting held on the fifth day of January 2021, and then now be read severally a first, second, and third time, and finally pass this fifth day of January 2021. All in favor of the motion. That is carried. And for the adjournment, and that would be moved by Deputy Mayor Watt, seconded by Councillor Snowblin, that Ashfield-Colborne-Wawanosh Township Council does now adjourn to meet again a week from today, the 12th day of January at 10 a.m. or at the call of the mayor. All in favor of the motion. And that is carried. I thank everyone very, very much. And please continue to stay safe.
Good day, all.
Thanks very much, all. Take care.